Topic for today is thyroid disorders in pregnancy. A stitch in time saves nine. So as Dr. Keshav very rightly said just yesterday, that if people get through the first two slides of the lecture, the remaining is going to be a cakewalk. So let's see how many of you will survive the hypothalamo-pituitary-thyroid axis. Just a brief recapitulation of your physiology. So as we all know, thyroid secretion is by the thyroid gland. But the main stimulus for secretion starts in the hypothalamus by the thyrotropin releasing hormone. Thyrotropin releasing hormone reaches the pituitary gland. Anterior pituitary secretes thyroid stimulating hormone, which is also called thyrotropin, which ultimately acts on the thyroid gland, namely the TSH receptors, giving rise to production of thyroid hormones. So 80% of thyroid hormone secretion is T4, whereas only 20% is T3. So as we all know, T4 is a pro-hormone. It is converted in the periphery of our bodies to T3, which is the active form of thyroid hormone. Okay, so this is facilitated by the enzyme deiodinase. T3 and T4 both have a negative feedback impact on the hypothalamus as well as the pituitary, and this helps in regulation of the thyroid hormonal levels in the blood. And the second slide, again, very important for you to understand the exact mechanism of action of antithyroid drugs and the rationale behind management of thyroid storm. Okay, so thyroid hormone synthesis. All of you should know this. It starts with iodine trapping. So iodine is the most important nutrient for thyroid hormone synthesis. Iodine trapping, so iodine is transported into the thyrocyte. This cell which you can see here, this whole thing is a thyrocyte. Okay. So iodine trapping takes place by the sodium iodine symporter. Iodine is transported into the follicle of the thyroid gland. Here it undergoes oxidation by thyroid peroxidase enzyme. Okay, so iodine is oxidized, followed by iodination of tyrosine residues. So the thyroglobulin molecules, which we all know are present in the thyroid gland, provide the tyrosine substrate for iodination. Iodination of tyrosine substrates occurs, and then there is a coupling. So this gives rise to formation of monoiodotyrosine, diiodotyrosine, and coupling of these gives rise to triiodothyronin, that is your T3, and T4, that is thyroxine hormones. So all these are stored in the thyroglobulin molecule. By pinocytosis, thyroglobulin is transported inside and stored ultimately in the colloid droplets. Colloid droplets undergo proteolysis, hydrolysis, and ultimately there is release of T3, T4 hormones into the bloodstream. Okay. Coming to the topic proper, pregnancy and thyroid physiology. So pregnancy acts as a stress test for the thyroid gland. Very important. There is an increased requirement for thyroid hormone during pregnancy to satisfy the maternal needs because of increase in the metabolic rate of the mother, as well as to satisfy fetal needs. So next line is very important. Maternal thyroxine is transferred to the fetus, that is transplacentally, and is important for normal fetal brain development, especially before onset of fetal thyroid gland function. Fetal thyroid gland starts functioning around 11 to 12 weeks of gestation. Before this also, thyroid hormone is important for the fetus, and this is provided by the maternal thyroxine. So what are the changes which take place during pregnancy? These are the physiological changes. Thyroid gland increases in size by 10% in iodine replete countries and by 20 to 40% in areas of iodine deficiency. So there is a normal physiological hypertrophy of the thyroid gland during pregnancy. Thyroid binding globulin increases as well. This is due to increased synthesis as well as decreased clearance. T3, T4 hormones also increase by nearly 50%. This is in conjunction with increase in the maternal needs. Daily iodine requirement also increases by 50%. So I have this graph which will explain to you better how each hormone rises during pregnancy. So the left side graph shows you the maternal hormones and their levels with respect to weeks of pregnancy. So we can see in the first trimester, that is around 10 weeks of gestation, there is a peak in the HCG hormone. Now, HCG is a very important hormone affecting thyroid levels in the first trimester. The alpha subunit of HCG hormone resembles very closely TSH, and therefore there is a cross stimulation by HCG of the TSH receptors. This causes a thyrotropic effect. It increases the free T4 levels in the blood, and due to increase in T4 levels, there is a consequent fall in TSH levels in the first trimester of pregnancy. So as HCG levels fall and come to their normal levels around second trimester, again the free T4 levels will also start falling and TSH levels will consequently start rising. Thyroid binding globulin, we have seen that it increases in pregnancy. Towards the end of the, towards the beginning of the second trimester, TBG levels are almost twice the baseline levels and then they plateau. Okay. And consequently, the total T4 also increases. Fetal side, if you see, all the hormones increase or start increasing in the first trimester itself. Only free T3 and total T3 start increasing in the mid-pregnancy time. So, normal changes in pregnancy which take place are increased iodine clearance, very important. This is due to increase in the renal clearance, as well as transplacental transfer of iodine to the fetus. So both of these give rise to a relative iodine deficiency in the pregnant mother. If this iodine is not supplemented, there is a risk of fetal and maternal hypothyroidism. Second change which you can see is placental deiodination of T4 hormone. So T4 is converted to T3 in the placenta by deiodinase. Increase in TBG we have already seen. This is mainly due to increase in the maternal estrogen levels. So estrogen is responsible for increased synthesis of thyroid binding globulin in the liver, as well as a decreased clearance of the protein. So increase in TBG causes increase in the total T3 and T4 levels. But remember, free T4 levels more or less remain the same because of its regulation by TSH receptors. Next, HCG hormone, we have seen in the first trimester, HCG increases. The alpha subunit cross reacts with TSH receptors, and therefore there is increase in free T4 and a consequent decrease in TSH. Third trimester, what happens? The placenta enlarges, and therefore there is increase in deiodination of T4 to T3. So T4 levels decrease, and because T4 levels decrease, TSH levels rise. So there is a relatively mild hypothyroidism towards the third trimester. Another important point is TSH receptor antibody reduction in pregnancy. So pregnancy, as we all know, is an immunosuppressed state. So patients with known cases of Graves' disease, even prior to conception, as pregnancy advances, TSH receptor stimulating antibodies reduce, and therefore there is an apparent improvement in Graves' disease. Remember, however, what happens after pregnancy or in postpartum period? There is again an increase in the thyroid antibody status. When the immunosuppression of pregnancy is lost, there is increase in the thyroid antibody status. This leads to postpartum thyroiditis or a Graves' disease exacerbation. We'll be seeing these in detail. Okay, now this is a concept, thyroid function testing and the reference range which is required in pregnancy. Now this concept, all of you really need to understand. There is a normal suppression of TSH during pregnancy. Okay, so in these patients, if we use the non-pregnant TSH reference ranges, that is 0.4 to 4, if we use this reference range, what is going to happen is, if you can see this gray area over here, these are all pregnant women who are actually hypothyroid. But because of normal suppression of TSH during pregnancy and because of use of non-pregnant levels of TSH, you're going to miss their diagnosis. Okay, so 30% of them will be falsely diagnosed as euthyroid. On the other hand, if you can see this gray region over here, this small curve, this area symbolizes women who are actually euthyroid, but because of suppression of TSH during pregnancy, you're going to misdiagnose them as subclinical hyperthyroidism. Okay, if you use the non-pregnant reference range. That is why there is an increased need for gestational age specific TSH cutoff levels to be used. And what are these levels? Now, these are recommended reference ranges by the American Thyroid Association, first given in 2011, reconfirmed in 2017. Okay, So for first trimester, TSH levels should be 0.1 to 2.5. Second trimester, 0.2 to 3. And third trimester, 0.3 to 3 milli international units per liter. Coming to iodine status and nutrition, we've all seen how iodine is a very important nutrient for thyroid hormone synthesis. The recommended daily allowance in a non-pregnant woman is 150 micrograms per day. In pregnancy, this requirement increases to 250 micrograms per day. Okay, median urinary iodine levels as defined by WHO for pregnant women is 149 to 249 micrograms per liter. But remember, this is not a measurement for an individual patient. It is a measurement in a given population. It is defined for a population. Why? Iodine levels are a population rather than individual marker due to wide diurnal variation. Okay, so iodine levels have a wide diurnal variation. You cannot do an individual testing of urinary iodine levels. So urinary iodine testing is not beneficial for individual use. So you need to know which population the patient comes from, which are the areas which are iodine deficient, which areas, especially the hilly areas, the sub-Himalayan belt, certain areas in the Western Ghats, especially in Maharashtra. Okay, so you need to know where the patient is coming from and whether she is consuming iodized salt. Most of the people now are consuming iodized salt thanks to the National Health Mission and their prerogative, but still you need to be aware of these because iodine deficiency can lead to a number of adverse effects. First being fetal and maternal goiter, increased rates of miscarriage, stillbirths, perinatal infant mortality, and in very severe iodine deficiency, there can even be cretinism in the child. So very typical picture of cretinism. It is characterized by severe mental retardation, puffy face, protuberant abdomen, delayed motor development, lethargy, apathy, thick protuberant tongue, deaf mutism, dry brittle hair, poor feeding, and short height. So remember, iodine deficiency is one of the leading causes of preventable mental retardation and low IQ worldwide in children. Okay. Wolff-Chaikoff effect. Now, this effect, you all really need to understand this because it has a number of clinical implications. So what is Wolff-Chaikoff effect? It is an autoregulatory phenomenon that inhibits the formation and release of thyroid hormones secondary to elevated levels of circulating iodide. So in case you have ingested increased iodine, what will happen? Ideally, what should happen? Increase in thyroid hormone synthesis should take place. But if that happens, you will go into thyrotoxicosis. To prevent this, there is a Wolff-Chaikoff effect. So what this effect does is it stops the formation and release of thyroid hormones whenever the body senses that there is suddenly an increased circulating levels of iodine. Okay, individuals with a normal functioning thyroid gland escapes this inhibitory effect and the thyroid starts functioning normally again. However, those with autoimmune disease as well as the immature fetus, they are not able to escape this Wolff-Chaikoff effect. So in these patients or in these populations, there is a prolonged inhibition of formation as well as release of thyroid hormones leading to hypothyroidism, which is why the WHO in 2011 have given standing guidelines which have been agreed upon by American Thyroid Association as well in the 2017 guidelines, that guidelines advise against exceeding an iodine intake of 500 micrograms per day. Because what will happen if increasing iodine passes onto the fetal side transplacentally, the fetus will not be able to escape the Wolff-Chaikoff effect and will go into hypothyroidism. Autoimmunity and thyroid disease. Now we all know that most thyroid disorders are linked to autoantibodies against nearly 200 thyrocyte components. So what are these various antibodies? First, thyroid receptor stimulating antibodies, which are generally seen in Graves' disease. Okay. Thyroid receptor blocking antibodies, they block the action of TSH on TSH receptors, giving rise to hypothyroidism. Thyroid peroxidase antibodies, we have seen peroxidase is an important enzyme in the synthesis of thyroid hormones. Antibodies against this will give rise to hypothyroidism. And last, antithyroglobulin antibodies. The last two are commonly seen in hypothyroidism, especially Hashimoto's thyroiditis. Okay, fetal microchimerism. Now, this is one of the implicating factors for increasing incidence of thyroid autoimmunity in pregnancy. So they say that fetal to maternal cell trafficking, that is whenever fetal cells, for example, mononuclear cells, passed through the placenta into the maternal circulation, it leads to an increasing engraftment of these foreign cells into the maternal tissues, especially the thyroid gland. And there is an autoimmune response against these specific organs, especially the thyroid. Okay, so just keep in mind, what is fetal microchimerism? Euthyroid autoimmune thyroid disease. Okay, so this is when the patient has a euthyroid status, the TSH, T3, T4 is normal, but the thyroid antibodies are increased or elevated. So universal screening for thyroid antibodies is not recommended. However, this entity is associated with sporadic pregnancy losses, preterm labor and abruption. A number of papers have shown an association with adverse pregnancy outcomes. Euthyroid women, pregnant women who are TPO antibody or thyroglobulin antibody positive should have measurement of serum TSH at pregnancy confirmation and then every 4 weekly, at least till mid-pregnancy. Okay, so should you treat this entity when the TSH, T4, T3 levels are normal, but thyroid antibodies are elevated in pregnancy? So what does evidence say? There is insufficient evidence for recommending levothyroxine therapy in TPO antibody positive euthyroid women who are newly pregnant, that is in their first pregnancy. But administration of levothyroxine in women who have a prior history of pregnancy loss may be considered. Why? Because potential benefits of levothyroxine are higher as compared to the minimal risk. Okay, so start with a minimal dose, 25 to 50 micrograms of levothyroxine per day. So these are the American Thyroid Association 2017 guidelines. Coming to hyperthyroidism in pregnancy, incidence is 0.2 to 2.7% of births. Causes include transient gestational hyperthyroidism. We are going to see this a little more in detail. And this is one of the most commonest causes of hyperthyroidism in pregnancy. Second, most common cause is Graves' disease. Other causes include toxic multinodular goiter, toxic adenoma, factitious thyrotoxicosis. Now, factitious thyrotoxicosis is it takes place due to inadvertent or even knowing excessive ingestion of thyroid hormones like levothyroxine or thyroid inducing drugs like amiodarone. Okay. Next, thyroid carcinoma. And there are other rare causes, which include TSH secreting pituitary adenoma. These are very rare. Struma ovary. We all know what struma ovary is, dermoid cysts with functioning thyroid tissue. Functional thyroid cancer metastasis. Germline TSH receptor mutations. Okay, these are the rarer causes. So how do you diagnose hyperthyroidism in pregnancy? Again, very important, history and examination. You cannot let go of these two. Very important to differentiate normal pregnancy findings from those of thyrotoxicosis, especially mild cases of thyrotoxicosis. So patients will come to you with loss of appetite, very common in pregnancy, especially in the first trimester. Failure to gain weight, again, common in the first trimester. Intolerance to heat, palpitations, anxiety, irritability and fatigue. Again, very commonly seen even in normal pregnancies. So you need to differentiate the two. Tachycardia, these are the signs now. Tachycardia, thyromegaly, exophthalmos, secondary to Graves' ophthalmopathy, diplopia, photophobia, again, secondary to Graves' ophthalmopathy, and tremors. Okay. On examination, especially in Graves' disease, you will find a diffuse neck swelling. So you make sure that thyroid examination is a part of your routine protocol of examining a pregnant patient. Okay, it's very important. So diffuse neck swelling, which moves on deglutition. It could be a physiological hypertrophy. It could be a Graves goiter. It could be autoimmune thyroiditis. Okay. But if on examination you find there is an irregular nodular enlargement, what are the differential diagnoses? Multinodular goiter, toxic adenoma or even thyroid carcinomas. Okay, for this you need to do an ultrasonography along with an FNAC for definitive diagnosis. Laboratory tests, TSH, most important test for any thyroid dysfunction because it has minimal inter-method biases. Second, free T4, again very important. And rarely you will come across an increased serum T3, which will bring you to the diagnosis of T3 toxicosis. Okay, so in hyperthyroidism, the TSH is markedly depressed. Free T4 levels are elevated. Coming to the first entity, transient gestational hyperthyroidism. Most common cause of hyperthyroidism in pregnancy, 1 to 3% is the incidence. And what is the cause? It is due to cross-stimulation by HCG. So we have already seen how HCG alpha subunit cross-stimulates the TSH receptors. There is a thyrotropic effect, very typically seen in the first half of pregnancy. Okay. And what are the lab values? There is elevated free T4 or adjusted T4 because of the HCG thyrotropic effect and a consequent suppression of serum TSH. But even more important than this is a very conspicuous absence of serum markers of thyroid autoimmunity. So TSH receptor antibodies will be very typically absent in this entity as compared to Graves' disease. And which are the conditions where you can very commonly see it? All the conditions where HCG is raised. So hyperemesis gravidarum, multiple gestation, hydrotidy for mole or vesicular mole, and choriocarcinoma. Okay, so the question remains, do you treat this condition with antithyroid drugs? So what do guidelines say? Antithyroid drugs are not warranted since the serum T4 levels come to a normal by 14 to 18 weeks of gestation. So this entity is actually to be managed only symptomatically with supportive care. For example, in hyperemesis gravidarum, you have to make sure that the patient is well hydrated, admit the patient if necessary, make sure her sugars are in control, antiemetic drugs if required, but antithyroid drugs are not warranted. Okay. One more reason why they're not warranted is because of their teratogenicity. So the first trimester, avoid. So how do you differentiate between gestational hyperthyroidism and Graves' disease? Okay, very important. She could be a patient of Graves' disease. It need not be transient gestational hyperthyroidism. So in a Graves' disease patient, more or less will always have a previous history of thyroid disease, okay, even before pregnancy. Presence of a pathological goiter, exophthalmos due to Graves' ophthalmopathy, and TSH receptor antibody positivity, okay. Whereas in gestational hyperthyroidism, no previous history of thyroid dysfunction, no goiter or a very slight physiological enlargement, no exophthalmos, TSH receptor antibody status is also negative. So, in the first trimester, when you come across a suppressed serum TSH, what is to be done? Keep these both these differentials in mind, first and foremost. And then, with the help of a medical history, a physical examination, and measurement of maternal serum free T4 levels for correlation, you will come to a diagnosis of whether it is a Graves' disease or gestational hyperthyroidism. So complications of hyperthyroidism in pregnancy, maternal complications include preterm births, miscarriages, stillbirths, abruption, preeclampsia, heart failure, even death in uncontrolled cases. So this highlights the importance of treating this condition in pregnancy. Okay, all these complications are more common in uncontrolled hyperthyroidism. What are the fetal complications? First is goitrous thyrotoxicosis. Now, this takes place due to presence of thyroid receptor stimulating antibodies which cross the placenta and stimulate the fetal thyroid gland. Okay. Second entity, goitrous hypothyroidism. This is due to the antithyroid drugs. Okay. Antithyroid drugs also cross the placenta and they can give rise to fetal hypothyroidism. Non-goitrous hypothyroidism is generally due to blocking antibodies, TSH receptor blocking antibodies, which can cause hypothyroidism in the fetus. And fetal thyrotoxicosis, this generally is seen when the patient has been treated by thyroid gland ablation just before pregnancy and then she has got pregnant. So what happens after a thyroid gland ablation is that there is an increased release of thyroid receptor stimulating antibodies, which keep circulating in the blood, and it takes a very long time for these antibodies to be flushed out. And these cross over to the fetal side, giving rise to fetal thyrotoxicosis. So how do you monitor the fetus? Fetal surveillance. Fetal thyroid size should be monitored by periodic USG from 20 weeks onwards, only if the patient has uncontrolled hypothyroidism, which is not being controlled on with antithyroid drugs, or an increase in the TSH receptor antibodies. Okay. If this USG shows any of the following, that is fetal goiter, growth restriction, or high drops, then and only then a cordosynthesis is advised to find out the cause of the goiter, whether it is fetal hyperthyroidism, as in the first case, fetal hyperthyroidism, or fetal hypothyroidism. So in fetal hyperthyroidism, you need to increase the maternal antithyroid medication dose despite the mother having a euthyroid status. Whereas in fetal hypothyroidism, reduce the maternal antithyroid drugs despite maternal euthyroid status. Okay. And coming to the management. So most important is preconception counseling. If the patient does happen to meet you before pregnancy, that's great. Thyroid function optimized with the lowest possible dose of antithyroid drugs even before conception. So prevention is always better than cure. Next, the first line of management are antithyroid drugs. We are going to look at these a little more in detail. Other options or modalities for management are thyroid surgery or radioiodine ablation. So thyroid surgery, generally it is done in the second trimester in pregnancy. Okay. And only in those patients who are not responding to antithyroid drugs or who are not controlled with even high doses of antithyroid drugs. In these patients, you can plan for a surgery. Thyroid receptor antibodies start gradually falling after surgery or after thyroidectomy. Therefore, this is the preferred modality if antithyroid drugs are not working and the patient is not yet pregnant, but she's planning for a pregnancy. So this is the preferred modality in this scenario. Radioiodine ablation, on the other hand, is contraindicated in pregnancy. Why? Because it can also lead to ablation of the fetal thyroid gland, which we do not want. Okay. As per all the radiological societies, avoid pregnancy for at least 6 months after radioiodine ablation. Okay, in the preconception period, if you have given radioiodine ablation therapy, avoid pregnancy for 6 months. Why? Because there is an increase in the TSH receptor antibodies, which can lead to fetal thyrotoxicosis. Antithyroid drugs classification. This is just a brief overview to get all of you all acquainted with the drugs once again. So inhibits hormone synthesis, these are the thionamines, most commonly used, propylthiouracil, methimazole, carbimazole. Okay. Inhibitors of iodine trapping, that is the sodium iodine symporter inhibition by thiocyanates, perchlorates, nitrates, generally seen in certain foods that we can eat, that is cabbage, cauliflower. Okay. So these inhibit iodide trapping. Inhibition of hormone release, iodine, sodium and potassium iodides, as well as organic iodide. So these inhibit the hormone release, that is T3, T4 release into the bloodstream. Destruction of the thyroid tissue by radioactive iodine, iodine 131, 123, 125, contraindicated in pregnancy. Okay, now where exactly, now all of you all know how thyroid hormones are synthesized, I hope. So where exactly do these drugs act? Okay, so just for a visual picture, anionic inhibitors inhibit the iodine trapping. Okay, that is the sodium iodine symporter. Peroxidase enzyme is inhibited by thionamide. So they inhibit the oxidation of iodine. Iodides and thionamides, both of them cause inhibition of iodination of tyrosine residues as well as coupling. Okay, and ultimately, iodides inhibit the ultimate release of T3 and T4 into the bloodstream. Another pathway, that is the peripheral conversion of T4 to T3, is also inhibited by certain drugs, because T3 is the active form which is actually responsible for the peripheral effects such as tachycardia. So the drugs which inhibit this are iodinated contrast media, beta blockers like your propranolol, esmolol, labetalol, amiodarone and even thionamides, especially propyl thiouracil. So propyl thiouracil has a dual action. So propyl thiouracil, just said, it inhibits thyroperoxidase also, and it is the preferred drug because it also has an additional action of partially inhibiting conversion of T4 to T3 peripherally. Okay, it crosses the placenta less readily as compared to methimazole. Therefore, it is the preferred drug in the first trimester of pregnancy. PTU-associated hepatotoxicity limits its use. So in fact, with regards to this, the US FDA had issued a warning in 2009 regarding PTU-associated fulminant hepatotoxicity. So following this, the guidelines have been modified to restrict PTU use in the first trimester and to switch over to methimazole in the second trimester of pregnancy onwards. Other adverse effects: transient leukopenia, but this does not warrant a cessation of therapy. Agranulocytosis. Okay, now agranulocytosis is a sudden and acute adverse effect. Even periodic or serial monitoring of CBC is not going to help. So whenever a patient comes to you with sudden fever, sore throat, and is taking PTU, send a complete hemogram, a complete blood count, and stop the usage of the drug. And ANCA, that is anti-neutrophilic cytoplasmic antibodies, very commonly associated with autoimmune vasculitis. They are seen in 20% of the patients, but a very small percentage of these actually develop a very serious vasculitis. So I wouldn't worry about this complication. Coming to methimazole, carbimazole, these drugs cross the placenta very readily. So it is not to be used in first trimester because it is associated with embryopathy, namely aplasia cutis, esophageal atresia, and co-anal atresia. So here you can see these pictures. They're not very pleasant, but aplasia cutis, which is congenital absence of the skin, okay, most commonly affects the scalp region and can affect variably other parts of the body, for example, the lower limbs. Okay, so these drugs should be avoided as far as possible in the first trimester of pregnancy. So PTU is recommended as drug of choice in the first trimester, methimazole beginning in the second trimester. And the dose, initial dose, is empirical depending on severity. So methimazole should be started 10 to 20 mg daily. So initial higher dose depending upon your the severity of the symptoms. And then according to your TSH levels and free T4, T3 levels, it can be reduced to 5 to 10 mg daily as a maintenance dose. PTU, that is propyl thiouracil, 50 to 150 mg thrice daily is the initial starting dose depending upon severity, and then you adjust the dose according to your TSH levels. So what is the goal of this treatment? The goal is lowest possible dose to maintain thyroid hormone levels slightly above or in the high normal range with suppressed TSH levels. So we do not want to overcorrect it. Okay, we need just minimal possible dose to keep the thyroid hormonal levels in the high range of normal. Okay, because these are toxic drugs. For example, PTU, prolonged use in high doses can cause fulminant hepatotoxicity. And how do you monitor? Monitoring is with TSH and serum T4 levels every 4 to 6 weekly. And always remember to tell your patients that these medications are to be taken at the same time every day for better control over blood hormone levels. If she's taken it in the morning, she should take it, continue taking it at the same time, more or less in the morning only. Okay. Thyroid storm and heart failure. Okay. Now these two are both life threatening and very acute and severe conditions, which thankfully thyroid storm is very rare in pregnancy. It is a hypometabolic state and can be precipitated in pregnancy in conditions such as sepsis or any severe infection or severe anemia, preeclampsia, and thyrotoxic heart failure also. It is already a hyperdynamic circulation in pregnancy. Plus, superadded thyrotoxicosis, especially if it is uncontrolled, can precipitate a heart failure. So, it is due to profound myocardial effects of thyroxine. It is a dilated cardiomyopathy because of increase in the circulating blood volume, a hyperdynamic circulation. So it is a high output heart failure. It can lead to pulmonary hypertension. Decompensation is precipitated, as I just said, by preeclampsia, sepsis, and anemia. and it's very common in uncontrolled thyrotoxicosis in pregnancy. So just a brief algorithm for managing such patients. So you start with thionamides. Preferred thionamide is propylthiouracil, and consider heart rate control, very important. Okay, so thionamides, propylthiouracil, 1000 micrograms loading dose followed by 200 mg every 6 hourly. Okay, heart rate control if necessary, if the patient is having tachycardia, propranolol, any of the beta blockers, propranolol, esmolol, labetalol should be given. Then next, after 1-2 hours of starting thionamides, start iodine therapy. Now this is where the Wolff-Tyckoff effect is applied. Okay, so increased levels of iodine in the blood will cause the Wolff-Tyckoff effect and will cause temporary stoppage or temporary inhibition of thyroid hormone synthesis and release. Okay, so that is the rationale behind using iodine in the management of thyroid storm and heart failure. So you can use sodium iodide, potassium iodide, or Lugol's iodine solution. In case the patient does have a history of iodine anaphylaxis, lithium carbonate can be used. Consider corticosteroid therapy for 24 hours. So this can be given in the form of dexamethasone or hydrocortisone. And the rationale behind using steroids is that they also inhibit the peripheral conversion of T4 to T3, which is the active form of thyroid hormone. Subclinical hyperthyroidism, what is that? Abnormally low TSH levels and normal thyroxine hormone levels. Incidence is 1.7% of pregnant women. Very important, it is not associated with adverse pregnancy outcome. It is proven in a number of studies, and also it does not warrant treatment in pregnancy because these drugs can affect the fetus. Okay. Coming to the most important aspect of thyroid dysfunction in pregnancy, that is hypothyroidism. If you see the incidence in India, it is extremely high, 4.8 to 12%. And what are the causes? First two causes are most important: Hashimoto's disease and iodine deficiency. Okay. Other causes include post-ablative therapy in Graves' disease, post-surgery, that is partial or complete thyroidectomy in Graves' disease, and rare causes include thyroid hormone resistance or central hypothyroidism with biologically inactive TSH. So overt hypothyroidism, the commonest cause is Hashimoto's thyroiditis. And diagnostic features, again, these need to be differentiated from normal findings in pregnancy. So fatigue, lethargy, constipation. All of us know all these three are very common even in normal pregnant women without thyroid dysfunction. Cold intolerance, weight gain, muscle cramps. On examination, you will find a pathologically enlarged thyroid gland, mostly due to iodine deficiency and Hashimoto's. Dry skin, hair loss, edema, prolonged relaxation phase of the deep tendon reflexes. Now, edema here is mixed edema, which is very typically non-pitting, as compared to pregnancy edema, which is a physiological edema in most patients, or even if it is PIH-induced edema, it is a pitting edema. That is because of fluid accumulation. Okay. Diagnosis, laboratory tests include serum TSH, free T4 and free T3. So in overt hypothyroidism, abnormally high TSH levels with an abnormally low thyroxine level. Okay, that's how you diagnose it. Management, replacement therapy is with levothyroxine. So the dose here is 1 to 2 micrograms per kg per day, approximately 100 micrograms per day. Women who are athyrotic, that is post-surgery, for example, thyroidectomy or after radioiodine ablation, may require higher doses. And how do you monitor these patients? In pregnancy, TSH is to be done every 4 weekly, at least till mid-gestation, and at least once near 30 weeks. However, if the TSH is not controlled, then you might have to monitor even more vigorously. Thyroxine dose should be adjusted by 25 to 50 micrograms, so small increments, till TSH values become normal. So most of the international professional bodies do not advise routine screening for thyroid function in all the women. However, the Indian Thyroid Society recommends, this is very important, recommends screening of all pregnant women, ideally pre-pregnancy, that is preconception period. If that is not possible, then at least on pregnancy confirmation, And if that is also not done, then definitely in her first ANC visit. So this was given by the National Health Mission issued in 2014. And these guidelines still hold true. Okay, so in hypothyroid women who are already being treated with levothyroxine and now they're planning a pregnancy and they have come to you. So what level of TSH should you optimize her dose to? So levothyroxine dose should be adjusted to achieve a TSH value less than 2.5 before the patient embarks upon a pregnancy. But following delivery, levothyroxine should be reduced to the patient's preconception dose. And an additional thyroid function testing should be performed at 6 weeks postpartum. However, in women in whom levothyroxine has been initiated for the first time during pregnancy, they may not require this levothyroxine postpartum. You can discontinue it, especially if the dose is less than or equal to 50 micrograms per day. Okay, if it is discontinued, then you should reevaluate for TSH levels at 6 weeks postpartum. Okay, another important aspect, when to take levothyroxine medication. What are you going to advise your patients? Levothyroxine should be taken definitely on an empty stomach because food affects its absorption. Okay. And traditionally, it has been advised to be taken before breakfast, at least 30 minutes, if not 60 minutes. So 30 to 60 minutes prior to eating anything early in the morning, it should be taken. It can also be taken at bedtime, but then there should be at least 4 hours interval between her dinner and taking of the tablets. And levothyroxine tablets should not be combined with any other medication. Okay. Also important to take it at the same time every day. You can't have her taking one tablet in the morning and one at night. Okay, so every day, same time has to be fixed for better hormonal control. Complications of hypothyroidism in pregnancy, miscarriages, preterm deliveries, low birth weight babies, gestational hypertension, stillbirth, abruption, cardiac dysfunction, fetal hypothyroidism, and very important, delayed neurocognitive development and lower IQ in the child. Okay. Subclinical hypothyroidism, a very important entity. A lot of our patients do have subclinical hypothyroidism in pregnancy, and the question always remains, should we treat them, should we not treat them, and what should we counsel them? So subclinical hypothyroidism is when there is elevated serum TSH level, but a normal serum thyroxine concentration. So studies have shown very conflicting results as to effect of subclinical hypothyroidism on adverse pregnancy outcomes, and therefore treatment of this entity remains a gray area. But what are the recommendations of the treatment? So levothyroxine therapy is recommended for TPO antibody positive women with a TSH greater than pregnancy specific reference range. There is a strong recommendation for this. TPO antibody negative women, but if the TSH is greater than 10, you definitely have to treat them. TSH greater than 10, 100% you need to treat these women. TPO antibody negative women, but TSH concentration greater than pregnancy specific reference range, but below 10, you can treat them, but there is a very weak recommendation for this and very low quality evidence. However, most of us do treat them because small doses of levothyroxine, as I already said, potential benefit is way more than minimal risk. It has a very minimal risk. There's no harm in treating them. That is why there is a weak recommendation for this. Isolated hypothyroxinemia is typically defined as low free T4, that is low thyroxine concentration, but a normal maternal TSH concentration, exactly opposite of subclinical hypothyroidism. Studies have failed to show any beneficial effect on cognitive development of the child following LT4 or levothyroxine administration, and therefore treatment of isolated hypothyroxinemia cannot be recommended at this time. And the last entity we are going to discuss today is postpartum thyroiditis. It has a very specific definition. Please pay attention to each and every word. Postpartum thyroiditis is the occurrence of thyroid dysfunction, excluding Graves' disease, in the first postpartum year in women who were euthyroid prior to pregnancy. Okay, so it is due to rebound of the immune system in the postpartum period after immune suppression in pregnancy. again, it is more common when thyroid antibodies are positive in the first trimester. Okay, so you have to look out for this entity. And in the classic form, it presents as a transient thyrotoxicosis, generally somewhere between 2 and 6 months postpartum. It is followed by a transient hypothyroidism around 3 to 12 months postpartum, with a return to euthyroid state by the end of the initial postpartum year. No treatment is required for thyrotoxic phase. It is a transient phase. It goes off on its own. But thyroxine replacement, at least 25 to 75 micrograms per day, is advised for hypothyroid phase because it can affect breastfeeding and lactation. So coming to, just to sum up, lactation and the neonate, congenital hypothyroidism, again, a preventable cause of neurocognitive impairment in fetuses as well as in neonates. Therefore, a universal screening is recommended in all neonates 2 to 5 days after birth, irrespective of the maternal thyroid function. Okay, coming to lactation, maternal hypothyroidism definitely affects milk production and milk letdown. So treatment is, of course, warranted in these women. Maternal hyperthyroidism does not significantly affect lactation. Treatment of these mothers should be like that in a non-lactating woman. Propylthiouracil and methimazole is secreted in breast milk in very small quantities, and therefore minimal possible dose is to be used. So methimazole should not exceed 20 mg per day and propylthiouracil should not exceed 450 mg per day. Iodine requirement we have already seen in breastfeeding and lactating women, 250 micrograms per day, just like in pregnancy. Okay, so that brings us to an overall summary of the lecture. Thyroid hormone is important for fetal neurocognitive development. Gestational hyperthyroidism does not need treatment with antithyroid drugs. Propylthiouracil should be used in the first trimester. Methimazole should be used second trimester onwards in hyperthyroidism. Subclinical hyperthyroidism does not warrant treatment due to low incidence of adverse pregnancy outcome. Overt hypothyroidism should be treated depending on trimester specific cutoff levels for TSH. And subclinical hypothyroidism should be treated, especially if thyroid antibodies are positive. Okay, so with that, I'll conclude.